Πουλωνία, Σιωάννα Ευαγγελιστά. Αγάδ, αγάδ, να αναγκυκά, την αγάια. At sa tabi nakatayo ng krus nga ni, ng krus nga ni Jesu Kristo. Inanyat ka patid nito't mahal niyang disipulo na nagdalamhati ito. Nang si Jesus ay makita ang dalawa, ang dalawa na Maria, kasama ng kanyang ina, at ang disipulo niya, si Juan na Evangelista. Agad-agad na nagwika, tinanghayan iyong anak, anak hayan ang iyong ina. Tinanggap ng alagad buhat noon sa San Juan, yaong birhen na nirahan sa tahanan. Inalagaan yaong inang minamahal. Nang matapos na nga ito, Nalaman ng poong Jesus na naganap na ang tanan. Siya'y nagbigay katuparan sa hula ng kasulatan. Nagwika siya kapag daka. Ako'y nauuhawan niya. Mga tanod na naroon sa sisidla na may suka, isinaw sa wang esponga. Ikinabit ang esponga sa hisopong sangabaga. Sa suka ay inilapit sa labi niya nang mapawi ang uhaw niya. Pagkasipsip niyong suka, nagwika ang poong Jesus. Sinabi ay natapos na. Iniyuko ang ulo niya't pumanaw ang kaluluwa.
Blessed afternoon, dear brothers and sisters. A few reminders before we begin the celebration here in the church. Please wear your face mask at all times. Kindly use the glass doors at the side as exit doors when leaving the church or using the comfort rooms. Let us always practice physical distancing. Dear brothers and sisters, this afternoon we gather for the celebration of the Lord's Passion. The celebration of the Lord's Passion is all about the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. We remember this sacrifice by reading and listening to the Passion narrative. We invoke this sacrifice to ask God to listen to our petitions. We adore this sacrifice by adoring the cross. We partake of this sacrifice by receiving communion. In this time of the pandemic, the veneration of the cross will not be the usual way wherein the faithful present will take turns to touch or kiss the image of the crucified Lord. We shall instead have the presider venerate the cross, and then certain individuals will come before the image to pray on behalf of all. The rest will privately pray in their places. After the veneration of the cross, we shall proceed to Holy Communion. To preserve order during the Holy Communion, kindly wait in your places until the stations have been set up. After the celebration of the Lord's Passion, we also invite you to pray the way of the cross. We shall assemble in front of the Sacred Heart statue outside the church. Let us continue to practice the basic health and safety protocols. Please rise. Let us kneel in silent prayer. Let us all rise.
Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery. He who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Let us now listen to God's word.
From the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of men. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. let me never be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
For all my foes I am an object of reproach, a laughingstock to my neighbors and a dread to my friends. They who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken. My trust is in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Servant, save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord.
A letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace and to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us honor the Holy Gospel. Let us all pray together the verse before the Gospel. Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden, into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let this man go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and guards were standing around the charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue, or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm. And they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
That is in order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king?
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas!
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews!
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And he said to them,
Behold the man!
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold, your king!
They cried out,
Take him away!
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, That is in order that the passage of the scripture might be fulfilled that says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a spring of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
It is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Please kneel. Please rise. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial clothes along with the spices according to the Jewish burial custom. Now, in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In July 2016, before his visit to Auschwitz, the most famous among Hitler's concentration camps, where more than 1 million Jews were exterminated, Pope Francis said that he would go there to pray, and he asked that God give him the grace to cry. Afterwards, after going through the barracks, standing in the gas chambers, and seeing the piles of personal items left by the dead, bags, pieces of clothing, shoes, The Pope seemed shaken and could only say, "Lord, have mercy on your people. Lord, forgive us for so much cruelty." Whether in Auschwitz or Hiroshima or Cambodia or New York, where museums have been erected to remind us of the crimes humans are capable of doing, one's natural or visceral reaction is that of shock, horror, and even grief. That is how it should be. And on Good Friday, we ought to feel the same way too, or even worse, for on this day, we remember how our Lord also fell prey or victim to man's violence and cruelty. Saint Ignatius precisely tells us this in the spiritual exercises. On the third week, when we contemplate Christ's passion, he says, we ought to experience a sense of sorrow, indignation, and even embarrassment or guilt. Our lolas and lolos, of course, got this. I grew up in a household where during Holy Week, laughter and loud conversations were banned. We were told to wear long faces because our Lord was suffering for our sins and we should commiserate with him. Sadly, we have lost this tradition, and with that gone, we have lost so much more. Friends, look around you. Death is upon us. It is everywhere. In the kids' movie, The Never-Ending Story, a malevolent force called the Nothing is sweeping the land. As a dark cloud, it rapidly covers every town, leaving at its wake creatures turned into stone, lifeless, and forests into wasteland. Our popes call this a culture of death. Death is all around us, but it doesn't seem to shock us anymore, unless you go to those museums. The senseless war in Ukraine is on its seventh week and has already claimed thousands of lives, including children's. And yet the rest of the world seems to be looking the other way. We have lost 6.2 million people, and maybe more, in this two-year-old pandemic. Shouldn't we pause and remember them before we undertake what economists call revenge spending? And of course, there is the infamous EJ case that has already claimed 6,000 lives according to the police, or 30,000 according to media, and is wrongly justified by the so-called peace now in our streets. Isn't that the mind of Caiaphas when he condemned Jesus to death? Because he says, it is better for one man to die than for the whole nation to perish. Death no longer shocks us. We have become inured by its ubiquity, desensitized, and perhaps even dehumanized. No one is an island. We learned that beautiful poem or song early on as children. But John Donne continues, "Any man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind and therefore never sent to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee." Do those words ring true for us? Does death really bother us? If there is one thing then that Good Friday teaches us, it is that we should recover that sense of shock and indignation and guilt, as Ignatius tells us. For today, our crimes have claimed the precious life of the Son of God. However, we cannot end there. We cannot end with the horror of Good Friday. Let me ask you at this point, what is the difference between a cross and a crucifix? I'm sure, as Catholics, you know the difference. When this church was newly built, at the altar, there was only the huge bronze cross. And Father René shared with me a small trivia. Some of the bronze for the cross came from mortar shells found when they were excavating for the Gesù Foundation. How fitting. But I thought then that the plain cross was perfect. It was elegant in its simplicity. And yet, it was incomplete. It was not Catholic at all. To end with just the plain cross is to end with horror, as I already mentioned. In Roman times, as we know, the cross was capital punishment, like its modern equivalent, the electric chair or the lethal injection. We cannot be praying to that, can we? And so rightly so, we Catholics place the corpus, the body of Christ on the cross to complete the picture, the story. Yes, on the one hand, it is important to continue to be horrified by the cross or the death of our Lord and the unjust, cruel, and violent deaths of every human being. But on the other hand, it is more important to remember the courage, the valor of our Lord in the face of death. As theologians tell us, it was clear to Jesus that his death would be the ransom for the many, the necessary atonement, the ultimate sacrifice needed to recover humanity from the clutches of sin and death. As it were on the cross, Jesus was making a stand for all of us, for love of us. All the hate, all cruelty, all the evil in the world, cast all of them to me, but let them all end with me here and now. Remember the tragic ending of the Fellowship of the Ring. Death, or the Balrog of Morgoth, was chasing after Frodo and his companions. They could have all easily been killed, but Gandalf made a last stand on the bridge of Khazad-dûm. You shall not pass, was his battle cry. On the cross, Christ was staring death in the face, staring the devil in the eye, and telling him, for our sake, you shall not pass. He was making the last stand for all of us. Friends, Good Friday challenges us then, first, to recover that sense of shock and horror over the scandal of the cross and the cruel and violent deaths all around us. More importantly, it admonishes us to recover the valor, the courage of our Lord in the face of death, and make our stand against it before it's too late. Yes, for death, my dear friends, is all around us. War, poverty, corruption, all these lead to death, and we need to make a stand against them. Truth has also been a sorry casualty of late. Common decency, civility, public morality, these are dying as well. And lest we point fingers on the usual suspects, remember that each one of us carry these seeds of death within us. Each one of us is a sinner, and our sins contribute to the culture of death around us. And yet, we can make a stand when we fight lies, when we share with the poor, when we forgive. We are making a stand. When we take on the courage of our Lord to fight evil with goodness and love, we are making a stand. When we as a people join hands to proclaim the victory of Jesus over Satan, we are making a stand. Today, on Good Friday, with the help and inspiration of our Lord, let us stare evil in its face and cry out for our children, for the future of the world. You shall not pass! You shall not pass!
In the celebration of the Word, we have been made aware that Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, offered Himself for all. Dying on the cross, He drew and united all people to Himself. Let us now bring before the Father the needs of the Church and the needs of all men and women.
Let us pray, dear beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty. Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Onesto, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church. Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that, enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Almighty, ever-living God, Grant that those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself. Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you, come to rest. Grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will for the true peace and freedom of all. Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace and freedom of religion may, through your gift, be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying. Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith. Almighty and merciful God, source of all life, health, and healing, look with compassion on our world, brought low by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. We shall now venerate the cross of Jesus. From being a symbol of cruelty and shame, the tree of the cross now stands for the salvation of the world because of what Jesus suffered. Please remain standing.
Behold, behold, the wound of the cross on which is hung our salvation.
Please kneel. Let us all kneel in prayerful silence. Please be seated. Because of the present pandemic, only selected members of the congregation will stand close before the crucifix to spend some prayerful silence. As people stand and adore on behalf of all of us, may God have mercy on us and continue to bless us. Let us also join the choir in singing the hymns.
Tristavite, responde mihi. Quia eduxite de terra Egypti, parasti crucem salvatori tu.
Magius vote. Deus, 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 Deus,
Desertum quadragintanis, et mana cibavite, et introdux in terram satis optimam. Parasti crucem salvatori tuum.
Agios ote.
Habite vineam meum speciosissimam. Et tu factes mic inimi sum ara, aceto numque siti meam potasti, et lancea perforasti latus salvatori tu.
Agios Deus, Sanctus Deus, agios Ischiros, Sanctus Fortis, agios Athanatos,
I am not moved to love you, O my God, that I might hope in promised heaven to dwell.
Nor am I moved by fear of pain in hell to turn from sin and fall.
Please rise.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father,
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. My dear friends, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are we called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
And may the body of Christ keep us safe for eternal life.
Amen. Please be seated. For an orderly distribution of communion, everyone is requested to stay in their seats until the communion ministers have reached their designated posts. Thank you.
Come, Jesus, and be my bride.
Pagsasalo,
Please rise.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please be seated for some announcements. After our celebration today, we shall have the Way of the Cross around the Bellarmine Field. Let us all assemble in front of the Sacred Heart statue outside of the church for the opening prayer of the Way of the Cross. Tomorrow, Holy Saturday, we sit by the grave of our Lord who suffered and died for us. We continue to pray and deny ourselves and seek the Lord in our lives. At 8 o'clock in the evening, we begin the last part of the sacred Paschal Triduum, the Easter Vigil. Please be prepared for a long celebration, as this is the mother of all vigils and the most solemn celebration of the Lord's resurrection. Please be prepared to enter the church in darkness. Our simple salubong will take place towards the end of the celebration tomorrow. Please rise.
Bow down for the final blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.